Landing a 40-meter-tall rocket stage that weighs as much as two city buses is not an easy task. The landing process of the Falcon 9 begins when the second stage breaks away from the first stage and continues on its journey to orbit. The first stage then has to perform a series of flips and carefully timed engine burns in order to land back at the launch site or on a barge parked in the ocean. After Miko, the first stage is traveling at hypersonic speeds and is on a trajectory that takes it hundreds of miles out over the ocean. The first step in recovering the rocket is to turn it around so it can get back to the launch site, or to slow it down enough so it doesn't overshoot the barge. After the second stage is a safe distance away, the first stage does a 180-degree turn and fires its engines. This is called the boost-back burn, and sets the rocket on a path to take it to its intended landing site. The landing location is usually selected based on how much fuel the rocket will have left. When launching smaller payloads, or to lower orbits, the rocket will often have enough fuel to get back to land. But on missions with large payloads or missions to very high orbits, the first stage might be traveling too fast or not have enough fuel left and will need to land on a drone ship offshore. Almost all of the early landing attempts were on drone ships. Some of these could have been sent back to the launch site, but SpaceX chose ocean landings for added safety and because they wanted to practice the ocean landings, which are more difficult than the ground landings. After the boost back burn, the rocket starts to fall back towards Earth and into the upper atmosphere. At this point, the grid fins on the top of the first stage are deployed. These fins help steer the rocket in the atmosphere. To prevent the first stage from breaking apart as it enters the atmosphere, it needs to slow itself down. So the engines are turned on once again for the entry burn. After the entry burn, the rocket coasts down to the landing site. Finally, just seconds before impact, the engines are lit one last time for the landing burn. This burn needs to be timed perfectly. Too early and the rocket will come to a stop before reaching the landing pad and begin to rise back up. Too late and the rocket will hit the pad hard and be destroyed. For the landing burn, the Falcon 9 usually only uses one of its 9 engines. But these rocket engines are extremely powerful, and the thrust-to-weight ratio of the stage is always above 1-to-1. This means it is impossible for the rocket to hover above the pad before landing. For these reasons, the landing burn has earned the nickname Suicide Burn. In addition to timing the burn perfectly, the rocket also needs to be completely vertical when it lands. The rocket has 3 methods for making sure it is pointing in the right direction. First are the grid fins. These help steer the rocket during atmospheric flight, but they don't work very well in the extremely thin upper atmosphere, or in the last seconds before landing when the rocket is traveling relatively slowly. The rocket can also control itself by gimballing its engines. This is a very effective control method, but only works when the engines are turned on. Finally, there are the cold gas thrusters. These can work at all altitudes and speeds, but don't produce much power. The cold gas thrusters are what create the white puffs of gas, which can be seen in many videos of the Falcon 9 landing. During the landing burn, the rocket also deploys its landing legs. The landing legs are made from carbon composite materials and aluminum honeycomb, and are deployed using a pneumatic system. The telescoping strut on the legs contains a crush core. A crush core is basically a one-time use shock absorber. This material will collapse on landing to help reduce stress on the rocket and must be replaced after each flight. After the Falcon 9 lands, ground crews can recover the stage for transport to a facility for refurbishment. SpaceX transported its first landed booster back to their headquarters in California, where it is now on display in front of their building. The booster recovered from the JCSAT-14 mission was sent back to the SpaceX test site in Texas, where it was loaded with fuel and test-fired multiple times. These test-fires help SpaceX determine what repairs or changes would need to be made in order to relaunch recovered stages in the future. SpaceX believes reusing the first stage of the Falcon 9 could reduce launch costs by as much as 30%, significantly reducing the cost of spaceflight.